How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity.
It is like precious oil poured on the head,
running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard,
down on the collar of his robe.
It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion.
For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore.
Amen.
Thank you. Eternal God, we have come to praise you and to give you thanks. You who created us and called us, you who are present in every moment to preserve and sustain us, you who love us with an everlasting love. Gracious God, when we see life only for ourselves, forgive us. In the knowledge of your steadfast love, work through us to bring your justice to the world, that all may experience wholeness through the power of your Holy Spirit. Restore what is lost, heal what is wounded, and gather in those who have been rejected. Help us to hear your transforming love speaking to us of respect, dignity, and worth, telling us that we are loved and that we are to love one another, everyone, always. Faithful Lord, today we lift our hearts to you in one voice as we pray.
We rest in your unchanging love, which will never let us go. Form in us such love, Holy God, as you sneak into the broken places of our relationships, subverting the jealousies, cruelties, and desertions you find there. Make a new future possible as you orchestrate, plot, supplant, heal, and reconcile through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Welcome to worship at First Baptist. We are so glad that you have joined us today. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we're so glad that you found us. We hope that you'll take a moment and visit our website, fbca.net. There you'll find a worship tab. Click on that and you'll find a guest card. We hope that you'll take just a moment and complete that. Send us just a little bit of information about yourself so that we can get to know you, know that you were worshiping with us today. We'd love to send you a note in the mail and let you know how glad we are that you joined us. Others of you may have a prayer request, a concern, a celebration. We want to know what's going on in your lives. We've missed you, and we want to know how we can best pray for you in the days ahead. To all of you, we are so glad that you have joined us for worship. When I was a kid, there was a song that I loved to sing in church. You probably know it. It goes like this. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. And then there's that second verse. I've got love like an ocean. The third verse. I've got joy like a fountain. And then my favorite verse, the one that had us all grinning and giggling in our seats, was that last verse when we got to put all three of those words in the place of where only one word had been in those previous verses. I bet you remember, it goes like this. I've got peace, love, and joy like a river. I've got peace, love, and joy like a river. Well, maybe you can finish the song a little bit later in the day. And yes, their emotions, we'll save those for another time. But I hope that thinking about this song has brought a smile to your face. And more importantly, I hope that you are experiencing God's joy as he brings each new day to us. And I hope that you know the love, the abundant love, great like an ocean, that comes from Jesus. And I hope that you are finding peace in a time that we so long for peace, in a world that is still uncertain. What was normal and routine for us of yesterday seems like such a long time ago. Today still seems so surreal. And tomorrow, who knows what tomorrow is going to bring for us. And so I hope that you, in this moment, sense the Holy Spirit wrapping arms around you, bringing you a deep peace. And we share that deep peace with one another, whether it's with those that are with you now, later today, or sometime this week. These words, the peace of Christ be with you. Not unlike the song, I've got peace like a river. Very simple, yet so profound. Would you share peace now with one another?
The truth and mercy.
This morning's reading comes from Genesis. Listen closely for God's word to us today. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of the Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me," and they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in these land for 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve you for remnant on earth and to keep alive for your many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen and you shall be near me. You and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I'm honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here." Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Do you believe in God? It's one thing to believe in God, to assent to God's existence, to respect or fear God, as the scriptures say. Do you believe in God? Yes, of course I do. Pollsters keep track of how many Americans believe in God. We use labels like believer or agnostic or atheist to categorize our belief or our unbelief. But no matter the labels we assume, it's quite another thing to believe in God's presence and activity in the details of our lives. To assent to God's interest in, or God's participation in, or God's direction of our circumstances or of our decisions. And these questions, as these questions go, I've learned that it's much more interesting and much more provocative to ask not whether I believe in God or someone else believes in God, but why God would believe in me. Does God exist? Not as interesting as do we exist? Why would God believe in us or trust us or work through us? Does God believe in us? Does God trust us? Does God work with and through us? What if we keep these latter questions in mind now as we remember the story of Joseph? Who is Joseph? He is Pharaoh's powerful vizier, a kind of vice president or a chief executive officer, Pharaoh's highest ranking officer, and practically his equal. In fact, Joseph calls himself the father of Pharaoh. The youngest son of Jacob, he'd been sold into slavery by his brothers decades before. Joseph was a precocious child then. You can imagine him running into the fields as his brothers worked the land and telling them of his dreams of how he was going to rise above them one of these days. And they would bow down to him. Not surprisingly, his brothers didn't enjoy hearing about Joseph's dreams after a while. And once, when they saw him coming from a distance, they plotted to destroy him. They quickly conspired to kill him and to blame it on the wild animals. His brother Reuben talked them out of it and into leaving him into a pit in the wilderness. Again, out of Reuben's sight, the other brothers sell Joseph to some passing merchants. And then the brothers take Joseph's elegant robe, his robe, his coat of many colors, or his robe with long sleeves, his elegant robe. They rip it in half and they soak it in goat's blood and they take it to their father Jacob to fool him into believing that Joseph indeed had been torn to shreds by a wild beast. And Jacob is inconsolable. Now we meet him today, well after Joseph has become one of which his dreams foreshadowed. He's now one of the most powerful leaders in the world. He has the upper hand over his brothers now. In a time of famine, they have come to Egypt to fetch grain for their family. They are unaware that they are appealing to their baby brother. But Joseph recognizes them. He manipulates them into bringing their other brother Benjamin back on a return trip. And as the chapter opens today, Joseph is no longer able to choke back the tears of his emotion in the repeated encounters that he is having and the memories that they're stirring up with his brothers. Overcome with emotion, he dismisses everyone but his family members and begins to sob so loudly, as we heard, that those in the Pharaoh's house can hear it. It echoes beyond the palace. The words, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" Decades after they threw him into the pit, decades after they sold him for 20 pieces of silver, after decades of hiding this explosive secret from their father Jacob, the brothers stand before their brother Joseph, the one whom they betrayed. In shock, in dismay, unable to speak. Can we step into the palace now to overhear the exchange? Again, the vizier says, "I am your brother, Joseph." They already feared him even before they knew his identity. Their nerves are already frayed by the constant worry of retribution from misunderstandings and Joseph's incognito manipulations. And now they stand before one of the most powerful human beings in the world, certain that he has every reason to punish them and every means to destroy them at his disposal. At least in this reading comes my very favorite part, the beginning of chapter 45, verse 5. This is when the music reaches a crescendo and the suspense reaches a fever pitch. When Joseph says to his brothers, "And now I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now," the hairs raise on the backs of his brothers' necks, their stomachs are sinking, cold beads of sweat arise. And now what? Off with their heads. To the torture chamber they go. Prepare the gallows. Or lock them away for decades and let them see how it feels. What does Joseph say to these who have left him for dead? And now, be not distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. If we read closely, it really is a bit humorous how quiet these brothers are throughout the story. For the duration of the narrative, they don't say a word, really until the last verse in our reading. And even then, we don't get any details. It's just, after these things, his brothers talked with him. And from this moment on, Joseph explains to them how God has taken all the evil things they've done and, well, how God has manipulated their manipulations, exploited their exploitations, outmaneuvered their maneuvers, redirected their orchestrations, and choreographed their corruptions into reconciliation, not only for an entire family, but for the salvation of a nation. God sent me before you. God sent me to preserve life. It was not you who sent me, but God. God has made me Lord of Egypt. We see God working in Joseph to reconcile and redeem. It's one of the great mysteries that Scripture teaches us, that our actions can be both God's and ours at the same time. And even that God will sabotage the wickedness of our time, using us as God's undercover operatives, if you will. I think of God's having done this and continuing to do this in the Pakistani girl Malala Yousafzai. Now a young woman who began advocating for girls' education under Taliban rule, her message of equality was beginning to spread and catch fire. When one day on her way home from school, a masked gunman boarded her school bus and asked the question, "Where is Malala? Who is Malala?" She identified herself and he shot her in the head, and she survived. And now, after many surgeries, she has founded the Malala Fund with her father, for which she has become the youngest ever Nobel Prize winner. And this spring, she graduated from Oxford University and continues her fight for justice for the 130 million girls around the world who face tremendous obstacles to education. God used this one to obfuscate, to frustrate the plottings of the violent for the sake not only of her and her own family, but for an entire nation and now many nations. And I also think of the late John Lewis, who, like Joseph, was left for dead by his brothers, in this case, his white brothers, on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. Can you imagine walking straight in to the line of gun and club-wielding officers of the law? Can you imagine just you and your peers walking straight into a wall as tall and as thick as centuries of white supremacy? Do we know how terrifying it is to stare into the dark tunnel of death, to be beaten, to have our skull cracked, to lose consciousness, and to watch the life seep out of our companions at the same time? Like Joseph, though, he became a powerful man in our land, a prime leader of nonviolent movements, a congressman for over 30 years. How many of us were as stunned as Joseph's brothers when we read Lewis's posthumous editorial last week in the New York Times, just days after his death? If what had happened to any of us, what happened to John Lewis had happened to any of us, what would come after the phrase, "And now"? In his last words to the nation, Lewis writes, "When historians pick up their pens to write the story of the 21st century, Let them say that it was your generation who laid down the heavy burdens of hate, and that peace finally triumphed over violence, aggression, and war. So I say to you, walk with the wind. Brothers and sisters, and let the spirit of peace and the power of everlasting love be your guide. This is the good news for each one of us today. That God, so unassuming in the world, partners with us that we may walk with the wind of God's breath and spirit to plot, to orchestrate, to choreograph. In God's name. And to do the works of Him who's called us into His marvelous light in ways that are so reflective of that light that it's really hard to tell the difference between what God is doing and what we're doing for others. Do you believe in God? What if God believes in us? What if God trusts us? What if one of God's greatest desires is to work with and through us? I believe, yes, Lewis was right to say it is our turn. It is our turn to let freedom ring. And now, dear friends, I invite you to remember chapter 4 of the Vicarious, which invites us to worship with one another weekly, to be grafted into the worship life of our community or any community, is to be grafted in to the very work of God in the world. What's to prevent you from coming, from jumping into the river of the life of God, to be submerged into God's will and way, to be part of God's work in the world of redemption and reconciliation. I thank you, each one of you, for your curiosity, for your faith, for the ways in which you let God take hold of your lives and shape them. I thank you for your gifts and encourage you to continue to give of yourselves, of your time, and of your money to support this community of God's will and way in the world. Remember the good news that God is with us. God will never leave or forsake us as we stand and sing our final hymn together.
please join me in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, we thank you this day for all of the good gifts that you have given to us, and we return a portion of that in these offerings. We pray that you would guide us as we use these offerings to further your kingdom in Asheville and beyond. We pray that you would teach us to love our neighbors and help us to see them in the light of your love. We ask for all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Friends, I encourage all of us for our opportunities for continued response today to consider a practice that was introduced to me when I was a member of a youth group. Every summer at the end of our mission trip, our minister would ask us to reflect on where we had seen God at work in our lives. I don't do this enough in my own life, but every time I do, I'm surprised by the joy that I find in recognizing God's signature in times of my life. Do that in your own life, in your prayers this week. Reflect, look back from your childhood to today and wonder, where has God been at work, overturning, plotting, choreographing, introducing reconciliation in the broken places? You might be surprised the peace that comes over you in recognizing God's presence in your own past. Let that be good news as we continue to respond to God's word throughout these very complicated and bewildering days. In all things, my hand is on my heart for you, for the love of our church, for the love of our city, for the love of the whole world, for the infinite beauty of God opens before us as the Spirit prepares us to be sent out to love the world in Christ's name.